to have you with us. If you would, open with me your Bibles to Matthew chapter 28. And this morning, the Lord laid it on my heart. If any of you follow me on Facebook, you noticed I put a post up. We're asked a lot of times about why did Jesus die? Why did Jesus die? How many of you can say, somebody's asked me that. Why did Jesus have to die? And we hear that question so often, and today we're going to take a look at that. But we're going to look at a question I think maybe even more important that is overlooked and neglected so often is, why did Jesus rise again? As we consider the last station of the cross, as it were, the resurrection of Jesus Christ this morning, I'd like for you to read with me in your Bibles in Matthew chapter 28, beginning in verse 1. It says, now after the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. And behold, a severe earthquake had occurred. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat upon it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. The guards shook for fear at him and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here. How many can say, praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
He is not here. If you don't have that hope, listen to me this morning, you're hopeless. In the worst sense of the word, if you don't have the hope of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you have no hope, but with that hope, you have all hope. He is not here, for he is risen, just as he said. Come, see the place where he was laid. Go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. And they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to report to his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and greeted them. How many of you know, even when you're in the midst of doing God's work, he comes and meets you and reminds you he loves you? And behold, Jesus met them and greeted them. And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and take word to my brethren to leave for Galilee, and there they will see me. That's an incredible, incredible story. How many of you have ever heard incredible stories that weren't true? Have you read the internet? Incredible stories. And just get our emotions going. And then later we find out that was not true. I remember when I was a teenager growing up, there was a fellow by the name of Mike Warnke that had incredible, incredible stories. A lot of people got saved through him. He was funny. He would make you laugh. He would make you cry. Later I found out none of those stories are true. He made them all up. And so often we get caught up in the emotion of a good story. But how many of you know this is more than a good story? This is fact. This is something that, as they say, you can take to the bank. And last week we considered some disturbing facts about professing Christians in the United States and what they believe. Just a few stats from last week, George Barna said of professing Christians, 45%, I want you to hear this morning, of professing Christians, those that say, I am a born-again Christian, 45% believe that a person being good will enable them to earn heaven. 45, could you almost, if that were true in this congregation, almost half of you would be sitting here thinking, I don't need Jesus as a Savior. I can talk about him and know a little bit about him and things like that and go to heaven. But the fact is that you must be born again. 33% of professing born again Christians do not believe that Jesus was sinless. That he wasn't the perfect spotless lamb. But they believe that Jesus must, if I couldn't go without sin, surely Jesus couldn't go without sin. So So it says 33% do not believe that he was sinless. And listen to this for today especially. 33% do not believe that Jesus bodily rose from the grave. Astounding what we believe today and what we don't believe today. And on this day, as we celebrate the resurrection, I'm convinced that we need to take a closer look at the purpose of the resurrection so that we can know why Jesus rose again. Father, this morning, I ask you in Jesus' name, Lord, that you would touch us, that you would perform the miraculous in us and through us. Father, that your glory would be revealed, that we would begin to really not just talk about the fact that Jesus rose again, not just appreciate what it means, but to know that we know that we know that Jesus Christ was, is, and always will be God. And he conquered death, hell, and the grave. He rose again. And one day, we can live forever with you, Father. Now, Lord, be exalted in this place, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So often the question again is, why did Jesus have to die? Let's take a look at the answer to that question. If you'll turn with me to Hebrews chapter 9, verse 11. Says that when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things to come, Jesus Christ appeared as the high priest of the good things to come. How many of you have experienced some of the good things that were to come? I tell you what, before Jesus Christ came, you had to have a burnt offering, a sacrifice. We've had a few of those in our house from time to time. It wasn't on purpose. Matter of fact, when we first got married, I thought the smoke detector was the timer for the oven. Where's Tish? She's with the kids. I'm okay.
It's recorded.
But before Jesus Christ came, that was how sin was dealt with. And even at that, that wasn't a completeness. How many of you would like to spend a huge portion of your income, go into the temple, take your offering that you bought, have them butcher that offering, have them offer it as a sacrifice to God, you walk out, you stub your toe on the sidewalk, and something blurts out of your mouth, and it's like, no! No, I just paid. No, it starts all over. It started all over again after and even that sacrifice wasn't enough. So as we look at this, but when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things to come, he entered through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this creation, and not through the blood of goats and calves, but through his own blood. He entered the holy place once for all. Aren't you glad Jesus was able to do it one time and he took care of it for all?
Yes.
He entered once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. Eternal. How long is eternal?
Forever.
Oh, you did it. Forever. One time. His sacrifice was so perfect, it covered forever. And as we look on verse 13, for if the blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of heifers sprinkling those who have been defiled sanctified for the cleansing of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, thank you Lord, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish, without sin. How many of you know Jesus was without sin? To God, how much more could he cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Let me tell you something this morning. If you are living with guilt after you have found Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you need to take a hold of that scripture. He cleanses you from all that. How much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offer himself without blemish to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works If you are feeling guilty about things that happened before you found Jesus Christ, He has covered that with His blood. And His blood is complete. Now, some of our mistakes have lasting effects upon our lives. But to allow guilt to render us useless, it says it cleanses your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. If He has forgiven you, let it go. It's done. It's over with. If there are lasting effects in other areas, you know, if I didn't pay my taxes for the 90s, and then I got saved, God will forgive me, but how many of you know the government won't? And they'll be saying, Uncle Sam will say, hello, nephew. You better do something or you're going to come and see somebody that ain't going to be good. And so I have to pay those things, but that's the price for some of those sins. We have those, the residual effects, but the forgiveness, the guilt, has got to be gone. And this morning, if you are living in guilt and you're a child of the King, you need to let go of that guilt. Let Jesus wash it. And sometimes the reason that we're living with that guilt is because we hold it so tight, God can't get His hands on it to take it away from us and wash it.
Amen.
And so He says to let go of that. Verse 15, for this reason, He is the mediator of a new covenant. How many of you like new and improved? Oh, I'll tell you, Little House on the Prairie, remember that? Doesn't it look sweet? Doesn't it look nice? They don't show Ma down there at the river. They do, but not very often. Scrubbing those clothes. They don't show the bathtub that everybody had a bath in, and you're the youngest kid. Sorry about your luck.
Same water.
Yeah, same water. All this, they don't show that because the old looks so nice. Let me tell you something. New is a wonderful thing.
Amen.
New is a wonderful thing. A new covenant. So that since a death has taken place for the redemption of the transgressions that were committed under the first covenant, those who have been called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance. Not only do you get eternal life, which is great enough for me, but there's an inheritance that goes with it that lasts forever and forever. Now, as we look at this, it's talking about the new covenant. Where did the old covenant begin? Where did the law begin? In the garden, man sinned. How many of you know Adam and Eve sinned in the garden? And Adam was such a manly man. Well, this woman you gave me. While he was standing right there with her while it was all going on, he had his hands in his pocket. Let's see what happens to her. If she lives, I'll know it's good. That's loving, isn't it? In the garden, they chose to disobey God. I don't know that it was as much about the fruit itself as it was the act of eating the fruit. That disobedience that took place. And so in the garden, sin entered in. Next, sin brought the curse of death with it. Not only a physical death, but a spiritual death. The fact that without a Savior to cover our sins, we would experience an eternal death. And how many of you know hell was designed for Satan and the fallen angels, his demons, that were supposed to be a place for them for eternity, and it wasn't designed for us. But with the fall of man, it opened up that opportunity. Man has to have a Savior, or else he's going to go the same way as the rebellious angels did. So sin brought the curse of death with it, not only physical, but spiritual death. And then God gave the law, the old covenant, with its requirements. And He gave those, I believe the best way to describe the law, He gave the law, it was a very good band-aid that, if its requirements were met, would keep a person from an eternal hell. That's what the law was. That's what the old covenant was. Until Jesus died for us, though the law being kept saved us from hell, heaven still wasn't available to us until Jesus died. Because Romans says in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, therefore there is now no condemnation. Remember what I said before about not being under that evil covering of guilt and anguish over past sins? Therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. Before Jesus, even though your sins were covered, you still weren't free from the law of sin and death. Verse 3, for what the law could not do, weak as it was as a band-aid, it was through the flesh, as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and as an offering for sin. Notice the word in the likeness, not as sinful flesh, but in the likeness of sinful flesh. And as an offering for sin, he can condemn sin in the flesh so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. See, before Christ died, those who embraced God's law were bound for a place called Abraham's bosom. Have you ever heard of that in the Bible? Abraham's bosom. Before Jesus Christ died, Jesus told the story of Lazarus, the rich man and Lazarus, and how the rich man didn't honor God at all and did all these bad things for and just lived for himself. And on the other hand, Lazarus, who was poor and had nothing and was sickly living on the streets, but he loved God and he honored God. And after they both died, the rich man was in the place of torment, and he looked up and across this gap that they couldn't cross in eternity there, and he saw the bosom of Abraham, and he saw Lazarus there, and he asked God, could you just have Lazarus, you know, let my brothers know. Send them back, do something. And he could see Lazarus over there. So we know the bosom of Abraham was a place. Not only that, but we also hear of paradise. And Jesus looked at the thief on the cross next to him, and he said, the thief said, when you enter your kingdom, remember me. And Jesus looked at him and he said, today you will be with me where? In paradise. That wasn't heaven. Jesus hadn't risen from the grave yet after 3 days. That day that he died, he said, today you will be with me in paradise. So we know that paradise was a real place, that it was the holding place, the resting place for those who honored God and honored the law before Jesus Christ died and rose again. And the names of those two names represent the place, but the fullness and the fulfillment of the law came through Jesus Christ. In that place, how many of you are glad that place called paradise, that place called Abraham's bosom, was vacated when Jesus rose again? If you look with me to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8, says, therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led captive a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. How many of you know that when Jesus led those captives, it was those who had been waiting in that holding place in the bosom of Abraham in paradise? They had been in that holding place, and Jesus came. And you ever been to a revival before? Could you imagine Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, all these, David, you know, Samuel, all these, they're down there and they've been talking about one day the Savior's going to come. And that day Jesus came. When he walked into that room and he began preaching a sermon about he was the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through him. You talk about a revival service where everybody was accepting Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Everybody came forward for the altar call. There wasn't a person sitting in a pew. And they came forward. And it says here once again, therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led captive a host of captives. And he gave gifts to men. Now this expression, he ascended. What does it mean except that he also had descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is himself also he who ascended far above all the heavens, so that he might fill all things. So we've answered that question. Why did Jesus have to die? Now for the question that needs to be asked. Why did Jesus rise again? And this is so vitally important. I know all of us have heard the story. All of us know that in our minds. But do we truly grasp why we have to know that he rose again? First, Jesus rose to prove that Jesus was who he claimed to be. How many of you know people claim to be messiahs? Over the years, many people have claimed to be messiahs. Even in our modern day, we've had David Koresh. We've had Jim Jones. We've had different ones that have proclaimed they were Messiah. And how many of you know a lot of people have died, but only one rose again to stay alive?
Amen.
Amen.
And so as we look at this, Jesus rose again, not because someone came and laid hands on him, and he rose again himself bodily by the power of the Holy Spirit alone. Romans chapter 1, verse 3, concerning his son, who was born of a descendant of David according to the flesh, who was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. Woo! That's important. He was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead according to the Spirit of holiness, Jesus Christ our Lord. Acts chapter 13, verse 32, and we preach to you the good news of the promise made to the fathers, that God has fulfilled his promise. Amen. That promise of life and life more abundantly. That's why Jesus said he came. And who better to give it than someone who took death back and threw it down and said, I am living again. That God has fulfilled his promise to our children and that he raised up Jesus. As it is also written in the second psalm, you are my son, today I have begotten you. As to the fact that he raised him from the dead, no longer to return to decay, he has spoken in this way, I will give you the holy and sure blessing of David. Therefore, he also says in another psalm, you will not allow your Holy One to undergo decay. That is a message saying that Jesus rose again. His body will not decay. He rose in 3 days to fulfill this scripture, saying that he is the Son of God. Verse 38 goes on and says, therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through him, forgiveness of sin is proclaimed. And through him, everyone who believes is freed from all things. Hallelujah.
Amen.
All things. You are, if you have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, yeah, the cares of this life might get a hold of things in your life from time to time, but you are freed from those things that will take you from God's hands, from which you could not be freed through the law of Moses. The old law couldn't do it, but Jesus Christ could. So first, it was to proclaim that Jesus was who he claimed to be and to prove it. Second, the resurrection proved his ability to forgive sins. 1 Corinthians 15:16 says, for if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. So it wasn't enough that he died for your sins. The scripture says that he had to rise again to make it complete, that you had no more sins if you were washed in the blood of Christ. Again, and if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. And the third thing, the resurrection provides a promise that we can live forever. Promise. People are looking to live. I know there are folks that take their life. I know people that don't value their lives. But for the most part, people are looking to make their lives last longer. People are looking for some kind of fountain of youth. People are looking for that pill that makes them stay young longer. All these things. But the bottom line is the resurrection proves that we can live forever. 1 Corinthians 15:19 says, if we have hope in Christ in this life only, we are of all men most to be pitied. If all we're looking for from Jesus is something in this life, we are to be pitied and are of all men most to be pitied. Verse 22 from 1 Corinthians 15. For since by a man came death, by a man also came the resurrection from the dead. When Jesus rose again, that resurrection promised that we would live forever. John chapter 15, verse 25 says, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me lives even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. If we believe in Jesus Christ, though this body may die, our soul and our spirit will live forever. So what's the requirement to receive that eternal life? Mark chapter 8, verse 34 says it this way. And he summoned the crowd with his disciples and said to them, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. We discussed that a few weeks ago when we were looking at the cross itself. When Jesus said, take up your cross, they didn't see some gold thing hanging around somebody's neck. They didn't see some wooden structure of a cross in an art piece hanging on a wall. They saw a terrible form of death. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my name's sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? For what will a man give in exchange for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will also be ashamed of him when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. We've got to let go of our life and embrace his. Luke 14:27 says, whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Wow, that's, you talk about just straight out. If we aren't willing to live for him, every moment of every day, not just sometimes, we don't just put on the garment of praise and then take it off and go back to what we were doing. Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. John 14:23, Jesus answered and said unto him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him. And we will come to him and make our abode with him. Jesus wants to have a place with you. Verse 24, he who does not love me does not keep my words. And the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. See, it's serious. Jesus Christ's death. Serious. He chose to be the offering for our sins. He knew what it meant to be the Savior, the Messiah of all mankind. He designed it. And when he was in that garden, and the pressure that was on him, and I know all of us have experienced pressure, but the pressure that was on him caused such a quaking, such a a twisting, such an agony within him. The Bible says he sweat, as it were, drops, great drops of blood. The medical experts can explain how that takes place, but they say it very seldom happens to a person, and that person is under stress and pressure that can't be defined. He who does not love me does not keep my words. My question to you this morning is, do you love Jesus? You may know about him, you may even know him, but do you love Jesus? John chapter 8, verse 31 says, so Jesus was saying to those Jews who had believed in him, if you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine. Are you continuing in the Word of God? Or do you only receive the spiritual food that you get when someone else spoon feeds it to you? If you continue in my Word, then you are truly disciples of mine. And you will know the truth. Oh, this is so important. And the truth will make you free. They answered and said, we are Abraham's descendants and have never yet been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? Oh, man. They couldn't even tell the bondage they were in sin. Jesus answered and said unto them, truly, truly, and I want you to understand, when Jesus repeated himself, there was purpose. But truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is the slave of sin. Everyone who involves themselves in sin is a slave to it. And you say, oh, Pastor, but I commit sin, but I'm a born-again Christian. Well, then that sin has to be covered right away by the blood of the cross. And if you're living in that sin, if you're living in that denial of who Jesus Christ was, and listen to me, if you're living in the denial of who Jesus Christ has called you to be, you're a slave to sin. Verse 35, the slave does not remain in the house forever. The son does remain. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. How many of you can say, I like freedom? And we live in a nation. Listen to what I'm saying this morning. We live in a nation where we proclaim freedom, while at the same time, a large percentage of our population is in severe bondage and slavery. If you start looking at our society, and first you take everyone that is incarcerated right now and living in that bondage, and then you take from that and you add to it those who are in a physical bondage because of health, and then you go from there to those that are in a bondage in their minds through addictions. We're a free nation. We're in bondage. Alcohol, drugs, pornography. And then those that are bound up and in slavery to debt. By the time you get done boiling down all these figures of different ones that are in different bondage for different reasons, some not of any choice of their own, it's just something that has happened. we're not as free as we think we are. But if the Son makes you free, then you are free indeed. My question to you this morning is, do you want to be free this morning? This Resurrection Sunday, to determine, I am not going to be bound any longer in this area of my life. I am not going to be bound by the images that come across that computer. I am not going to be bound by a credit card bill that's coming to me. I'm not going to be bound by this health issue in my body. I am not going to be bound by fear and anxiety over the future. He who the Son makes free is free indeed. In John chapter 3, verse 3, Jesus answered and said unto him, and as we're looking at the last question, what is required to receive that freedom, that eternal life? Jesus said unto him, truly, truly, I say unto you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of heaven. And this morning, I want us to take a look at that verse. Unless one is born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Born again. Made new all over again. The man that was asking him the question, what do you mean born again? Do I have to enter into my mother's womb again and be born all over? No, newness that takes place. Scripture says, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed, be changed, be born again. How? By the renewing of the mind. You must be born again. You must have a new thought process. And this morning, I believe the Holy Spirit is asking you, has your mind changed since you've been born again? Why would you want to be born again to be the same person you were before? You must be born again, brand new. And this morning, I believe that the Holy Spirit wants to speak into your hearts and reveal to us through the power of the Spirit that he wants to change our minds and our thought process so that we can experience true freedom that lasts for an eternity. Because as the scripture says that we just read, if you just believe in Jesus for what it'll get you during this lifetime, you're to be pitied. Because there's so much more in eternity. This morning, I'd like to ask everyone to close your eyes and do your best to open your spiritual ears and let the Holy Spirit speak into your life right now. Forget everyone around you and listen to what he's speaking into your life. Holy Spirit speaking to some of you, telling you that you don't trust him. Holy Spirit, just stirred some people. Awakening them. Father, this morning, I pray a covering, a fullness, and an assurance. Give us ears to hear what your Spirit is saying, and hearts, Lord. This morning, with no one looking around, every eye closed. And you would say, Pastor, I need a change in my life. I want to make sure that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. If you're here today, with every eye closed and every head, say, Pastor, pray for me. I'd like just to ask you to raise your hand so that I can see you and agree with you. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Anyone else, the Spirit has been stirring your heart. And you need to make a change in your life. Raise your hand. I feel like there's just at least one or two more people that need prayer this morning. I'm not going to embarrass you or ask you to leave your seat. I believe God wants to do a work in your life. Anyone else this morning? Yes. Father, I thank you. I thank you for newness. Lord, I thank you for renewal that takes place. Lord, I thank you for those that have responded today and said, I need a change in my life. I need to reestablish who I am in Christ. I need to establish Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, or I need to take hold of some things that I've been letting just kind of fall by the wayside. Father, today, in Jesus' name, Father, I ask for a renewing. I ask, Father, that you would apply the blood of Jesus Christ to these lives. Lord, that you would set them free. Right now I proclaim, be free in Jesus' name. All things are passed away. They are dead. But all things, hallelujah, all things are new again for those who are in Christ Jesus. And Father, I proclaim that. I believe that in Jesus' name. And Lord, for anyone here today that was unable to raise their hands but was wrestling with you, Father, I pray that they would, before the sun sets, come to that place with you. That place of complete surrender. Father, that your Spirit will flow over them, that the blood of Christ will wash them, and that their minds might be made brand new. Father, we thank you. Lord, we lift up the needs of those who couldn't be here today. Lord, just this morning, family with a loved one passed away. Another family with a loved one was put into hospice. Father, I pray a peace over them, a comfort, Lord, an anointing that will cover them, soften them, and warm them in your presence. Thank you. Now, Father, we thank you for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And because he lives, not only can I face tomorrow, but I have hope for an eternity. Thank you, Father. Thank you that Jesus Christ rose again. Now, Father, I pray your covering over each one in this place. And I speak a blessing. A blessing of walking, not by sight, but walking by faith and trusting you. Because we know without faith it's impossible to please you, Father. I speak the blessing of each one that we will walk in a manner worthy of the gospel. I speak the blessing of being the servant of the Most High God. I speak the blessing of knowing beyond any shadow of doubt that they are ready to stand in your presence. Lord, I speak the blessing of passing all of that on to everyone we come into contact with. Now, Lord, I count it as done. Through the power of the Spirit of God, knowing that the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in me, quickening this mortal body, enabling me to do what I cannot do on my own. Thank you now, Father, for all this. We give you all the praise and the honor and the glory in Jesus' name. And everyone who received that said,
amen.
Amen. Amen.